Yannai Gonczarowski.
Perfect, perfect, yeah.
As part of our guest speaker here at the UEA. Yannai is an assistant professor of economics and computer science at Harvard University, and he's the first faculty member at Harvard to have been appointed to both of these departments. Yannai is also a professionally trained opera singer, having a bachelor's and master's degree in classical singing from the Jerusalem Academy of Music and Dance. He also has a textbook co-authored with Noam, Nisan, Mathematical Logic, which introduces a new approach to teaching the material of basic logic course to computer science students. Today, Yannai is with us to explore a number of examples using approaches, aesthetics, and techniques traditionally originating in computer science to derive economically important
insights. Thank you so much. Thank you so much for the invitation. Thanks everyone for being here. It's such a beautiful day today that I know the competition is tough. So thank you so much. So I guess this title requires some explanation. So when you think about things that could lie at the intersection of computer science and economics, you probably think about machine learning. You know, lots of opportunity for economics. Probably think about cryptocurrencies, Bitcoin, Ethereum, maybe other stuff. Maybe you're thinking about ad auctions. You know, whenever you search for something on Google or Bing or whatever, there's like a split second auction that's performed where companies bid for the right to show you their ads. That's actually whenever you press enter on Google, there's another auction has just taken place. And maybe you're thinking about algo trading, you know, algorithmic trading, high frequency trading, which is becoming, more and more significant. And, you know, I also asked Midjourney to tell us how it visualizes computer science and economics, apparently lots of fruit, maybe agricultural economics or something. I don't know. It's the language also looks interesting. The bottom line is that the talk today will be about none of these. The talk today is going to be about the intersection of economic theory and theoretical computer science. And it's kind of weird to talk about the intersection of two theoretical fields because they both use mathematics to prove theorems. You know, whether you're an economic theorist or a computer science theorist, use math to prove theorems. The thing is that the flavors of theorems in economics and theorems in computer science, somehow the flavors and the tools are quite different. So economic theory, even those of you who are going to go through grad school and do, a PhD in economics and do economic theory, for the most part, all of the theorems that you're going to see throughout your studies can be bucketed into three big buckets. The first one is existence theorems, in all of these markets an equilibrium exists or something like that. The second kind is uniqueness theorems, in these markets, there is a unique equilibrium or maybe there are a few equilibria, but there is the payoff at equilibrium is unique or something like that. And the third kind of theorem is an optimality theorems. You know, here is the mechanism that maximizes welfare, revenue, whatever. So a lot, those are of course what I'm saying now is like, everything you could say in a line is a generalization, but I would say that if you see a theorem that doesn't bucket into one of these three, unless you're taking my grad course or a similar course, it's going to be maybe one throughout your entire PhD. And economic theory has refined over decades techniques to prove these kinds of theorems. On the other hand, computer science has a whole different kind of bucketing of its own. There are approximation theorems? What's an approximation theorem saying we want to solve some computational problem? We don't know that this here's an algorithm to do that. We don't know that it's optimal in terms of, you know, running faster than any other possible algorithm, but we can somehow prove that it's not too bad in the sense that no other algorithm is going to run so much faster than this algorithm. You know, we can quantify, you know, how much, you know, we can put some bound on how much overrunning time we're doing by running this algorithm. Another thing in computer science is kind of thinking about complexity. Maybe to solve a certain problem, you need a very complex algorithm. So you can ask, what would less complex algorithms give you? What would the algorithms that run faster give you? And you can couple that with approximation, ask, what's the trade-off between running time and the quality of the solution, for example? All of these I'm presenting to you in terms of running times and algorithms, but the idea of approximations, the idea of complexity, as we'll see today, can be applied regardless of any computation. And the nice thing is that computer science has, like economic theory, refining over the decades, tools for these kinds of theorems. Computer science has concurrently refined other tools to prove these kinds of theorems. And today we're gonna talk about applying these kinds of theorems and these kinds of results, like computer science aesthetics, theorems to give economic insights. So specifically today, I'm going to show you three vignettes, you know, three kind of short-ish examples that each of them demonstrates how approaches, aesthetics, or techniques that are traditionally used in computer science can be used to derive economic messages. So the first one, we're going to talk about loss bounding. That's going to be our econ version of approximation algorithms. Then we're gonna talk about complexity, but not about computational complexity, about other kinds of complexities. And this is gonna allow us to see how this idea from within computer science of trading off simplicity and loss bounding, the same kind of loss bounding from here, can be imported into economics. And finally, I'm going to show you a setting in which, you know, there are no algorithms per se, there is no computation, but still algorithmic thinking really, you know, helped us to define things properly and reach the theorems that we wanted. So let's start with the first one, loss bounding. This is going to be this is the only one of the three parts of today's lecture that's not going to be based on my work. This is based on work by Tim Roughgarden and others in the early years of this century or millennium. So driving to MIT today. So MIT is, you all recognize our beloved River Charles. MIT is about here. Harvard Computer Science is about here. I actually came from my office, which is my main office is in the economics department, which is here, but for the sake of this story, I need the river between Harvard and MIT. So let's say that I came from the computer science building. And coming from the computer science building here, there are two, you know, general ways to travel. Either you cross the river and then you drive, or you drive and then you cross the river. And assume for, you know, simplicity, there's only one road through which you can do this and one road through which you can do this. And assume that as I was leaving Harvard Computer Science, 140 other cars were leaving the same building headed toward MIT. They're all still stuck in traffic. But, and furthermore, you know, we're going more and more away from reality, but the point here is to demonstrate an idea. Assume that these two roads that I've colored in red, they're kind of, you know, very good roads if there are only few cars on them, but they get congested really quickly. So assume that, you know, if you have 100 cars on this road, it takes you 10 minutes to get from side to side. If you have 200 cars, it takes you 20 minutes, and the same for this road. And assume that for the other two gray roads, those take, you know, they're quite long, but, you know, they're, you know, wide lanes. You know, this is a Memorial Drive, this is a Stewart Drive or whatever. So it takes 15 minutes regardless of how many cars. Even if there are 1,000 cars, it's going to be 15 minutes. But even if it's one car, it's going to be 15 minutes. So assuming that 140 other cars left with me, how would you expect the traffic to divide between, you know, south of the river and north of the river? Feel free to yell out. Would all the cars go north of the river? Would all the cars go south of the river? Something else? What do you think? 50-50. Sorry? Half and half. Very good. What's your name? Thank you. Thank you for being the first to speak. It's always a challenge. Yeah, thank you. So yeah, so half and half. So, you know, these are kind of the same. We're going to have 70 cars at the top. So it's going to be 70 cars. So this red thing is going to take 7 minutes, 15 additional minutes here. And for the 70 at the bottom, it's going to be 15 minutes here. And then 7 additional minutes here. Overall, driving time of each car, or if we want to be slightly more general, the average driving time is going to be 22 minutes. Now, suppose that the cities of Cambridge and Boston, in their infinite wisdom, decide to build a bridge over the river here. That's going to allow you to cross instantaneously from one side to the other. Anyone have a guess regarding how traffic is going to flow now? So it's, again, it's me and 100, so overall 140 cars, including me, want to get from here to here. But now we can utilize this bridge. Any suggestions on how traffic will look now? Who's going to take which route? Yeah.
I would imagine that, like, all of them take the top, then cross, and then take the bottom, because that'd be like, oh, wait, no, that doesn't make any sense. Never mind.
No, that actually makes a lot of sense. What's your name?
Santi.
Santi. Thank you so much. So, yeah, you're perfectly correct. So we're going to have all cars here, all cars cross, then all cars here. Why? Let's take a look. So if all the cars go here, it's going to be 14 minutes to this point. Still beats taking this and getting here in 15 minutes. And then all the cars are going to be here. So another 14 minutes, which strictly beats this with 15 minutes. So actually all the cars are going to do the cross, drive, cross again, drive, cross again. And the overall travel time, 14 plus 14, is going to be 28 minutes. So we built a bridge, and the entirety of traffic suffers. So you may imagine, you know, that this is kind of a story about this schematic imaginary Cambridge-Boston. But this actually happens in real life. So, you know, if adding a bridge might increase driving time, you could, you know, the equivalent of that in reverse would be destroying a road segment might actually help with driving time. And this actually happened in Seoul, South Korea, a couple of decades ago. They tore down a 6-lane highway and replaced it with a 5-mile-long park. So, you know, a lot of highway was torn down. This actually improved traffic flow despite, you know, it's not the case that, you know, a lot of people felt traffic would be so horrible that they moved from driving to taking the subway, all these things. They actually had a similar number of cars on the road every day, but people just got to where they wanted faster. So this actually happens in real life. The question is, what's going on here? So this is phenomena that I've shown you is known as Brace's paradox. It goes back to the 60s. Computer scientists or operations researchers would describe it as inefficiency due to strategic behavior. Economists would call it inefficiency due to drivers not internalizing the externalities that they impose on others, right? As economists, you know, what do you mean due to strategic behavior? Strategic behavior is the first thing. That's what drives everything. for computer scientists and operations researchers, you know, for decades there's been optimization problems. Then about 20 years ago, someone started throwing, you know, more constraints at them because of strategic behavior. So, but you know, so whatever your background is, one of these should be speaking to you. And we know that, you know, one way to resolve this is to help people internalize externalities, impose tolls on the red roads or whatever, but say that we cannot do that. So classical economics would tell you adding road segments might increase the equilibrium driving time. And computer science would ask you, by how much can adding road segments increase the equilibrium driving time? And so let's draw a really stylized model. So out of the three things I'm going to tell you about today, only in this one will we see, you know, a model of any kind. The next ones are going to be like more informal, but just to show you that these things can be formalized and proven completely. So let's say that we have a set of places and a set of roads, and each road connects two places. So think about places as junctions or intersections and roads connecting them. We have K cars, can be 140, can be 1,000,007. Each car has an origin and a destination. These are two places from which it wants to go and where it wants to go. And a flow is a designation for every car of a path that it will take from the origin to the destination. And the load on a specific road induced by a specific flow, let's call this Li. This is simply the number of cars using this specific road under this flow. And, you know, I'm kind of ignoring time here. Maybe, you know, someone here is using that road in the beginning of their drive and someone else at the end of their drive. I'm going to ignore all that and assume it's kind of, you know, simultaneous enough just for simplicity. There are ways to overcome these things. And let's say that the travel time on road E, let's call this CE of the load. Oh, sorry, this should be LE, not LI. I'm so sorry. So this should be CE of LE. So we take the number of cars on the road and we apply some monotone function to it, monotone or increasing or whatever. It means that as there are more cars, the travel time is going to be either the same or higher. It's not going to be lower. And the total travel time of a car is just the sum of the travel times on the different road segments through which it passes. And we're going to say that a flow is an equilibrium if no car can reduce its travel time by switching to another path, taking a different route, if everyone else remained where they are. So no single car is going to want to change from north of the river to south of the river, assuming that everyone else remains where they are. And a very famous theorem that goes back to a paper by Rosenthal in the 70s says that an equilibrium exists. You know, some markets have equilibria, some don't. Here, there's an equilibrium. And the average equilibrium travel time is unique. So it means whichever equilibrium you choose, the average travel time is actually going to be the same. There are some equilibria are going to be better for some people, worse for some other people, but on average, all equilibria are kind of the same. So remember, we talked about existence theorems, uniqueness theorems in economics. And another thing is that, you know, the average equilibrium travel time may not be optimal across all flows. We kind of saw this already that, you know, in equilibrium, maybe everyone goes north and south, but that's not optimal because there are other flows that would get everyone there safer. So, you know, existence, uniqueness, optimality, that's our bread and butter in economics. And, you know, then come computer scientists in already this millennium and say, if all congestion functions are linear, so, you know, the time you spend on a road is a linear function of the number of cars, then actually the average equilibrium travel time can at most be 2.5 times the optimum. So this says it's not optimal. This says, yeah, but it's not super, super, super bad as well. We can actually bound how bad it's going to be. So you may say, well, 2.5 times, that's horrible. But, you know, if you're a planner and you know that the travel time in some area, the average travel time is 25 minutes, this tells you that the, you know, if it's currently in equilibrium 25 minutes, then this tells you that whatever you do, the optimum is not shorter than 10 minutes on average. You can ask yourself, is it worth dedicating the resources of your town to shave off 15 minutes? It kind of gives you maybe an even too optimistic idea of what the best case could possibly be. So this theorem is due to these very smart guys or gals. And note that specifically in this, you know, our example of schematic Boston or Cambridge, all congestion functions were actually linear. Those were number of cars divided by constant, that's linear. And those were just constant plus zero times the number of cars, that's also linear. So this actually applies here, but you know, there we had a slightly different question. It wasn't equilibrium versus the optimal thing, it was equilibrium before adding a bridge and equilibrium after adding a bridge, but that's, in some sense, this is, we're almost there. So in any road network with linear congestion functions, you can ask by how much can adding a bridge hurt travel time? So let's calculate using this theorem. So the new equilibrium travel time is gonna be, by this theorem, at least 2.5 times the new optimal travel time. This is with the bridge and with the bridge. And the new optimal travel time with the bridge is either the same or better than the original optimal travel time without the bridge, because the bridge only gives you possibilities. Whatever is optimal here is at least as good as whatever was optimal without the bridge. And the original optimal travel time is, you know, either the same or better than the original equilibrium travel time, because optimal means optimal. So overall, we get that the new equilibrium travel time with the bridge is at least, it's no worse than 2.5 times the original equilibrium travel time. So this actually lets you prove that you will never hurt travel time by more than multiplying it by 2.5 if you add a bridge or several bridges or whatever. So this was a very, you know, short example on loss bounding, but let's move on to some stuff that's more complex. And this is going to be based on a paper of mine with Moshe Babayev and Noam Nisan and another later paper of mine. Let's talk about revenue maximization. I'm trying to make things interesting by giving each of these three examples from a different world. We have the first one from traffic games. This is going to be from revenue maximization. The last one is going to be from matching markets. I hear that Parag's course is very popular here, and rightly so. So revenue maximization. So say that we have a seller. Seller has N items for sale to some potential buyer. You could ask, why does it make sense that there's only one buyer? So think, maybe there are many buyers, but you know, we look at them one by one. Think maybe you're Apple Music. You know, you have many, many potential buyers, but you give each of them a separate offer of how much they can pay for things, and there are no really real constraints. You know, you can sell the same music track as many times as you want to different buyers. So you can analyze the buyers one by one. So assume that you're Apple Music, you have N possible music tracks to sell, and there's a potential buyer. And the buyer has some value, VI, for each, you know, music track I or item I. And we're going to make this simplifying assumption that the valuation is additive over the items. So if the buyer, let's say that the two items that I want to sell to the buyer, this phone and this clicker, if the buyer values this by $3 and this by $8, the buyer is going to value both of them together by $11, which is the sum. So unlike if those were the two clickers, where probably the buyer doesn't need two clickers, so the value for both of them is going to be less than the sums of the values. And unlike the case of selling both of my shoes, for example, where I think most buyers would kind of have value zero for just one shoe, but maybe more than zero for both shoes together. And the seller crucially does not know the buyer's values. The buyer's values exist in the buyer's head. The seller has some partial information about these values, and we're going to capture them, as is usually done in economics, with some prior distributions, F1 through Fn. We're going to assume a dependence. So the seller imagines as if V1, the value for item 1, is drawn from distribution F1, V2 is drawn from F2, V3 is drawn from F3, et cetera. And you know, a main question in the field of mechanism design is how does the seller maximize her expected revenue? Expected is over these distributions, assuming that the values are really drawn from these distributions. And the seller can choose any way to sell, what we call any mechanism. But you have to bear in mind that the buyer can strategize and opt out. What do I mean? I mean that if I'm the seller and I'm going to ask the buyer, by how much do you value this clicker? And then, you know, what I plan to do is to tell the buyer, well, 1 cent less, take it or leave it. Then the buyer is going to answer my first question by 1 cent, even if the buyer, if she values it by $1 million. And the second thing about opt out, my selling mechanism cannot be, you must pay me $1 million for this, because the buyer is going to say, well, I'm not participating. I'd rather pay you nothing and get nothing. But, you know, given these two constraints, do whatever. So let's do a warm up with a single item. So one possible way to sell an item is to choose a price at which to offer the item, you know, $5, take it or leave it. And if you choose a price P, then the revenue you're gonna get is P times the probability that the buyer's value is greater than P, right? Because if the buyer's value is greater than P, the buyer will agree to the sale and you'll get P. But there are also other ways you could imagine. You know, you could imagine this kind of multi-round thing. I'm going to ask the seller first, do you value this by more or less than 5? Then I'm going to ask the seller, are you an academic? Maybe that means that they value clickers very highly, et cetera. Maybe lottery tickets. Maybe I'm going to tell the seller, you have the buyer, you have a choice between paying $5 for a 30% probability lottery ticket to get this, or $6 for getting it for sure, whatever. You know, the space of things to do here is fairly rich. There's a beautiful theorem by Meyerson and Riley and Zeckhauser that says if there's only one item, there's actually no way to sell that can give you higher expected revenue than offering the item at the revenue maximizing price. It's a beautiful theorem. And really the intuition here is that if you try to do some clever stuff, the buyer is going to strategize against you and it's not going to happen. So what about two items? So how can the seller maximize expected revenue if there are two items? So I'd like you to recall that the valuations are independent. You know, the distributions are independent. The valuations are additive. So, you know, in this case, the problem decomposes. It's actually optimal. You know, we price this as if this were the only item and price this as if this were the only item, right? So whenever a speaker asks right, you should be wary. Maybe not. Let's see an example. Assume the item values are independent. So our buyer will value this with probability 0.4. So with probability 0.4, we'll value this by $1. And with probability 0.6, we're going to value this by $2. And same for this, probability 0.4, $1, 0.6, $2, independently. And just to make things interesting, don't think $1, $2. Think 1 million, 2 million. You know, so there's a lot at stake here. So if we price separately, so if we price this by $1, we're going to get $1 for sure. If you price this by $2, we're going to get $2, with probability 0.6. That's an expectation, $1.20. So better to price it by $2. So if we price this by $2, this by $2, we get in expectation $1.20 for each. Overall, we get $2.40. This is the extent of math you'll see here today. Sorry for this. But what if we do the following thing? And you know, I'm wearing short sleeves today because it's warm. But anyway, I would have worn short sleeves here today because I need you for, I'm going to do a magic trick and I need you to see that there's nothing up my sleeve. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to put both of these together and I'm going to tie a ribbon around them. And I'm going to tell the buyer, you can only buy both of these together, not any of them separately. And I'm going to offer this bundle for $3. And the buyer will accept unless she values each of those by $1. It's enough for her to value one of these two by $2 in order to accept. So she's going to accept with probability. So the probability of valuing both by $1 is 0.16. So she's going to accept with probability 0.84. So the expected revenue is going to be 0.84 times 3, which is 2.52. It's actually greater than 2.4. So this whole problem decomposes, optimal to sell each item separately, that's simply false. So maybe it's not so much a warm-up to items. So we saw an example. This is actually, you know, simpler numbers, but there's some tie here that I wanted to avoid in the example that I showed you. But this works the same way, and the unique optimal way, you know, I'm not lying to you. This is the unique optimal. There's no other way is to offer the bundle for $3. And you say, okay, so maybe, you know, offering the bundle makes sense. You know, maybe, you know, if I had 100 different items, it kind of makes sense that we would bundle them together, right? Because on each of them, there is some uncertainty. But if you bundle all of them together, they're going to be worth, like, roughly the same regardless of anything, because, like, there's, like, laws of large numbers and stuff like that, et cetera, et cetera. So that's, you know, so if really each of these is worth $1 or $2 with probability 50%, if you have 100 items, about half of them are going to be worth $2. The other half is going to be worth $1. So you're going to have, you know, if you sell for slightly less than $150, you're going to be okay. So that's, like, you know, intuition actually for why you should bundle, right? Okay, by now you should know that the word right should make you suspicious. So it turns out that if you tweak the distributions only a little bit, it's actually optimal to sell separately. And it turns out that if you tweak it slightly further, then the optimal mechanism is neither of these. And you know, the buyer has a choice between getting nothing or paying $2 for any one of them of her choice, or paying $3 for both. And if you tweak it slightly further, it turns out that the unique optimal way to sell includes lottery tickets, those things that didn't help us with a single item. So the options for the buyer is either you pay nothing, you get nothing, or you pay $4, you get both, or you pay $2.50, you get the first item for sure, and the second item with probability half. You know, we're going to toss a coin after you choose to pay me $2.50. That's the unique optimal thing. That's the only way to maximize expected revenue. This is a result, by the way, due to some folks at the computer science department here at MIT. And it turns out that if you take, you know, this looks different, but, you know, this means, you know, if each item's value is distributed according to a beta distribution, sounds scary, but it's a nice distribution. It's a distribution on the value between 0 and 1. It has a polynomial density function. It's you know, if you were just to see it out of context, it would, you know, there are worse distributions in the world. And here it turns out that the unique optimal way to sell, unique up to, like, small things because there are infinities involved, you need to, whatever you do, you need to offer the buyer the choice between infinitely many different lotteries. And for the mathematicians here, between a continuum of different lotteries. So it's not even countable. Again, folks at the CS department here. More generally, we you know, even two items, IID, it's kind of embarrassing. You know, we've been doing economics for a while, but we don't know what the general form of the mechanism is. We don't have an analytic solution. We don't have a formula. We completely don't understand the structure of how to sell two items by one seller to one buyer. And, you know, it may be complex, it may be randomized, it may have infinitely many outcomes to offer. It's very hard to represent to the buyer. You know, how do you tell the buyer, here is a list of infinitely many options to choose from. It's very hard for the buyer to figure out what to choose. There are some other stuff that, you know, those may be non-monotone. Actually, if you move from specific distributions to distributions that look better because they're, you know, higher, they're stochastically dominating, if anyone knows this term, then you know, it might actually reduce the optimal expected revenue, which is very non-intuitive. Let me throw in a computer science-y thing. It actually may also be very hard, given the distributions, to calculate what the optimal auction is. If anyone knows here, NP hardness, Sharpe hardness, stuff like that, this is this basically is a way of saying we don't think we'll be able to calculate this thing even in 100 years, even with quantum computers. So here's the point where we put our computer science hats on and we ask, what revenue can we get using simpler ways to sell? So we have no idea what the optimal revenue would be because we have no idea what the optimal mechanism looks like, but we want to say things like simpler mechanisms would not lose more than so-and-so in revenue. So here's one way to do that. So we need to decide when we say simpler, what's simple, what's complex, and there's a lot of latitude here, but let's focus in on something concrete. So every optimal way to sell, every mechanism for one buyer, every optimal mechanism is equivalent to a menu. What's a menu? You know, you say, if you pay me $3, you won't get the first item, you will get the second item. If you pay me $4, you get the first item with probability 20%, the second with probability 30%. If you pay me $10, you get the first probability 40%, the second with probability 6%. And you can always choose to pay nothing and get nothing. You get the point. And we're gonna call the number of entries, not entrees, even though this is a menu, the number of entries we're gonna call the menu size. And we can ask, what is the smallest menu size that would always suffice for 90% of the optimal expected revenue? Say that we don't want optimal revenue. We're happy with getting 90% of the optimal we could have gotten. What's a menu size? Is there a finite menu size that will always suffice? And if so, what is it? What is it for 99%, for 99.9%? More generally, you know, computer scientists would say that what we're asking is, what does the revenue look like as a function of complexity? So if this is the revenue and this is the complexity, how does this look like? As economists, I would urge you to flip this like this and say that, you know, this actually is the trade-off between high revenue and simplicity, right? If we flip it, then this is no longer complexity, this is simplicity. So this is, you know, this kind of lets us explore the Pareto frontier between revenue and simplicity. And turns out that we can give actually quite detailed answers on what this Pareto frontier looks like, despite, you know, like, you know, we can kind of give two curves between which this lies, lower bounds and upper bounds and stuff like that, despite not knowing what the optimal way to sell is. This kind of complexity thinking is kind of a coarse lens that, you know, even if you don't know what the solution is, you can say something about how complex it is, what its menu size is gonna be, et cetera. And we have a theorem with my co-authors from earlier. It's actually a combination of theorems from the two papers that, you know, it's the message from it, I promised you, you know, economic messages, one item really is qualitatively different, so much easier. But all other numbers of items turn out to be qualitatively the same. So even though we don't know how to optimally sell even two items generally, this kind of gives us an indication that if we understand how to sell two items, we won't get stuck again between 30 and 31, something completely different kicks in. So something completely different kicked in between one and two items as we saw, but that's kind of it. After that, we don't think there's this, you know, looking at how menu sizes change and looking also at, you know, you can ask the same question up with menu size, but how much computation, I promise I wouldn't say computation, how much communication is needed between the seller and the buyer? Or, you know, certain, how many samples from the distributions do you need to not overfit, or all kinds of various things. You know, you can take any number that is you know, a function of a mechanism. You can pick any, you know, it could be the menu size, could be the communication, whatever, and you can ask, you can call that a complexity and look at these graphs and solve and try to figure out what's going on here. And, you know, what we end up having here is that, you know, really one item is different, but two items and more looks like it's behaving roughly similarly. So hopefully if we understand two items, there's no additional roadblock going ahead. So this is what I had to tell you about the example of how to trade off simplicity and loss bounding. And the last thing I'm going to talk to you about today is kind of more amorphic, but you know, just to show you that there's, you know, this is by no way limited only to these three things is kind of algorithmic thinking and when you would want to do that when you don't care about algorithms or about computation. So this is based on a very recent paper of mine with Ori Heffetz and Clayton Thomas. So let's talk about matching. Those here who took Parag's class, Parag Pathak's class will know this, will know this story, but let me repeat it anyway. Two-sided matchings of agents are everywhere. You know, you can think about matching doctors to hospitals, students to schools, lawyers to law firms, patients to kidney donors. And, you know, we do many of these in you know, very big computerized ways, you know, or the fact that it's computerized matters less, but, you know, we collect preferences from doctors or students or lawyers or patients, and we collect their priorities at the different hospitals or schools or whatever, and we want to find a good matching. And what every person who, you know, student or doctor or whatever, who has to interact with such a matching mechanism asks themselves is, how should I rank the institutions? Should I do this straightforwardly? Just say, you know, put first the hospital that I want first, or the school that I want first, put second the school that I want second, et cetera? Or maybe should I strategize? Maybe somehow non-straightforward ranking will give me something that I prefer, because maybe, you know, I don't have a shot at the school that I want first. So if I'm gonna drop it off the list and promote my second choice to be my first choice, maybe I'm gonna get it, and otherwise I'm not gonna get it. And, you know, for example, the NRMP, National Resident Matching, National Resident Match for doctors to hospitals, matches tens of thousands medical residents every year in the US alone. They have a very professionally made video on their website explaining their matching system. It's called the deferred acceptance algorithm. It goes back to the 60s by Gale and Shapley. And what's in the video, if you take a look at the video, they explain how the matching is calculated. You know, if you have everyone's preference list, how do you calculate the matching? What's not in the video, and but it's not too hard to figure out, everyone in this room could figure that out, is that it's the matching is what we call stable. If I'm a doctor and I didn't get into some hospital that I ranked above my match, then this hospital must be filled with higher priority applicants, people who have higher priority at that hospital over me. What's not in the video, and I don't know anyone who, based only on the video, could prove this off the top of their head, is should I rank in a straightforward way, or might it be beneficial for me to strategize? Take a look at the video, they kind of say things like, they say various things, but none of them are super convincing. And what applicants care about is actually not how the matching is calculated, not is it stable, but should I rank in a straightforward way, or might it be beneficial to strategy? And that's actually, to some extent, the only thing the video doesn't answer. I'm hesitant to ask this, but how many people here even recognize one or two of these, let alone the six? Okay, very good. Three of these? Four of these? Five of these? Six of these? Oh my God, okay. Okay, turns out deferred acceptance, the algorithm that they use a variant of it, but let's ignore that. It turns out that it's actually it is what we call strategy proof. Non-straightforward behavior will never help you in this algorithm. But the proof is delicate, it's subtle. When I teach it in my undergrad course, it takes more than an hour to teach it. It's very subtle. It's not something you could hand wave to parents of students who have to choose schools. And in practice, you know, the NRMP website and other places tell you something like, you know, it's you should rank truthfully because economists who won the Nobel Prize tell you that that's what you should do, which is actually true, but it may not be very convincing. And, you know, we have evidence that applicants try to game the system, not only in experiments in the lab, but actually, you know, in real life, in very high stakes situations, people don't fully believe this statement that you should be truthful, even though you should. And so you say maybe so DA, the proof is very delicate. Let's move to some other algorithm. And the problem is that DA is the only way to select a matching based on preferences that is both stable and strategy proof. Stable, we talked about, means that if I don't get into some hospital then it's filled with people who are preferred to me at that hospital. And strategy proofness means that there is no reason to strategize. So if you want to not strategize and you want people to not have to strategize and you want a stable matching, you're stuck with deferred acceptance. But the proof is hard. So what do you do? So here we ask the following question. Is there an equivalent description of deferred acceptance? So it's the equivalent description of, same mapping from preferences to outcomes, but how somehow describe it in a completely different way. Maybe a way that, is equivalent to the normal way, but maybe it's very hard to see this equivalence, but somehow strategy proofness is going to be more apparent from this new way of describing it. Could ask, what does it even mean? It's either strategy proof or not. What does it mean equivalent and more apparent and stuff like that? So let me give you an example. Ignore matching for a moment. Let's talk about voting. Say that we have, till when do I have? We started slightly late. Sorry.
You have until 5.
Until 5. Mm. Okay. So let me do this quickly. Yeah. So single peak preferences. Okay. What does it mean to have single peak preferences? There are 5 options for mayor, let's say, to vote for. Either we want 1 or 2 or 3 or 4 or 5 to be a mayor. And each of you think of these as, on a spectrum from left wing to right wing or something. So, each of you have your preferred peak, and as you move away from it, you like things less and less. And so here's one way to aggregate votes. Say that we have 3 voters. You can sort them from lowest to highest and pick the middle vote. So if the votes are 2, 3, and 5, winner is going to be 3. If the votes are 2, 2, and 3, the winner is going to be 3. How many people here who have not seen this mechanism, how many people have seen this before? Out of the people who have not seen this before, how many people think that this is strategy proof, that you should actually vote for your peak? How many people here think that you should vote, say, more extreme than your peak to get your peak in the right place or something like that? Okay. Here's a different rule. I doubt that anyone has seen this one before, so this is open to everyone. So we're gonna pick voter 1, and we're gonna tell voter 1 the following. Let's call the obtainable numbers the votes of the 2 other folks and everything in between. So if the 2 other votes are 1 and 4, the obtainable numbers are anything in between. And then the one thing that we're gonna elect, we're gonna take a look at your vote, and we're gonna elect the thing that's the obtainable number that's closest to your vote. So if your vote is 2, we're going to elect 2. If your vote is 5, we're going to elect 4, because that's the thing that's obtainable, that's closest to your vote. If the other 2 votes are 4, for example, doesn't matter what your vote is, 4 is going to be the thing that's selected. So we take a look at it. We don't take a look at your vote yet. We take a look at the other 2. We decide what's the set of obtainable numbers. Then out of these, we choose the thing that's closest to your vote. How many people here think this is strategy proof? You should vote for your peak. How many people here think you should not vote for your peak? Okay. Let me tell you a secret. It's the same mechanism. If you sort and then pick the middle thing, it's exactly the same as taking a look at the other 2 and picking the interval, the thing out of the obtainable ones that's closest to you. But somehow we think the strategy proofness is clear for the second description. There was at least one person here who voted that the first one is not strategy proof and the second one is strategy proof. So, but we experimentally tested that. We made up this interface. The only, for half of the people, we said the 3 votes will be sorted from lowest to highest, and the middle one will be elected. The other half, we said the obtainable numbers, blah, 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 blah. We checked how many people vote for their peak, how many people try to manipulate in some way. Truth-telling jumped from 70% to 80% in the new description. Furthermore, if you take a look at the people who you know, who were straightforward, who voted for their peak throughout all 10 rounds, we did this for 10 rounds to make sure whether people move or not move, then it jumps from a quarter to a half. So it seems like there is something in this new description that makes strategy proofness clearer. At the same time, it makes consistency harder to see. What do I mean? If I tell you that we're going to take a look at the votes of two orders, you know, see the obtainable numbers, then pick the thing that's closest to you. But I tell you we're going to take a look at the votes of the two others, and, you know, then we'll take the thing that's close to you. It's really unclear why the result of this description and that description is going to be the same. Which is very clear when I say, you know, let's sort them, pick the middle one. So we do lose something here. And similarly, for deferred acceptance, this thing that matches students to schools everywhere, we found a new description. It's actually a hard thing to show that they're equivalent. It's almost as hard as proving that the original description is strategy proof. But it also makes, you know, it makes strategy proofness clearer. We hope we're still running the experiments. We think it's true, though, because it's at least as clear as in the interval description, it seems. But makes consistency harder to see. And here we want to ask, is there a description that makes both of these clear? So what you want is a theorem that says, out of all possible descriptions, there exists or doesn't exist something that makes them clear. But how do you formalize a theorem that starts with among the set of all possible descriptions? How do you formalize a description? And here we realize, well, a description is kind of like an algorithm. Right, you explain things in steps. Maybe we can borrow some formalisms from algorithms. So I'll be very, you know, careful here. I'm very much not always in favor of this approach that, you know, our mind works like a computer, so whatever is complex for a computer is complex for our mind, et cetera, but you can carefully import things if they make sense and tweak them if they don't. And here we have a theorem that says no simple description. Simple here is some definition that tries to formalize hard to grasp rather than hard to run the computer, can make both of these clearer. So importing some definitions from the world of algorithms actually helped us be able to formalize and prove a theorem here. So, and once again, it's also a saying which we don't care about how hard it is to compute things or computational complexity or running time or stuff like that. I'm almost over. Sorry for being a few minutes over. So we talked about these three vignettes, and if we had time, I could throw in cryptographic theory, another example, and I could throw in statistical learning theory and whatever. And, you know, maybe all of these notes are far beyond computation. I never once mentioned running time throughout this entire talk, nor would I if I would add these at the bottom. So this intersection between computer science theory and economic theory is far beyond computation, supporting ways of phrasing theorems and tools and ways of proving theorems and stuff like that. And who knows, maybe your future paper is going to be here. One last slide. Let me shamelessly self-promote under the guise of inviting you to learn more. As you know, you can freely subscribe. MIT students can sign up for Harvard courses. Harvard courses can sign up to MIT courses. My grad course, it has actually two numbers, one in economics, one in computer science, and two names. For economics, it's a computer science toolbox for modern economic theory. For computer scientists, it's economic analysis is a frontier of theoretical computer science.
If you switch them next year, no one would know
it was
wrong.
Both of them teach both. But actually, this year, we had a very balanced class. And even more so than last year. Last year was also quite balanced. This year was, you know, almost perfectly balanced. And the discussions between the different students were actually super, super interesting. So these two ways of looking at it, I think, really enrich the class. But this is, grad level theoretical course. If you're not that much into theory, I also give an undergrad course. It's less about this computer science-y thing, but you also see very funky places in which incentives, you know, make really weird things happen in real life. You know, we start with a paving the road thing. We go on to a variety of different things. So you're all invited. And I'd like to thank you, and my kids thank you as well. Thank you so much. If you have any questions, now or offline later, or whatever, I'm around.
Thank you so much. Thanks.